Welcome to the Spring 2020 Madden Challenge Competition, a competition hosted by the Daniels College of Business. This competition has taken place every fall, winter, and spring quarter since 2012, but tonight has the distinction of being the first Madden Challenge hosted online. My name is Joshua Ross. I'm the Director of Entrepreneurship in the Daniels College of Business, and I'll be your host tonight. We have almost 200 people participating in this online event from all over the country. We appreciate your support and involvement with tonight's event. I like to bring up silver linings during this time of uncertainty. Drives my kids crazy, but I think it's important. Normally, this event is hosted on the University of Denver campus. An example was the video that we watched leading to the event tonight. But tonight, our online format gives us the opportunity to welcome guests that would normally not be able to attend and to showcase our talented students to their friends, parents, alums, and the Denver business community. Up on the screen is our handles, our different social media handles. Please follow us tonight on all of our social media channels and use the hashtag DUMaddenChallenge. We have a very special guest who will kick off the event tonight. It's my pleasure to introduce the Dean of the Daniels College of Business, Dean Chaudhary. Dean.
Thanks, Josh. And good evening, everyone. I know you can hopefully see me and hear me. And I am delighted to welcome you to one of the signature events at Daniels, and that is the Madden Challenge. I remember very fondly my last two experiences with the challenge down in Marcus Commons. As Joshua said, it's in the form of a science fair, and it was exciting to walk around and see all of the various student projects. So let me start by saying, why do I call it a signature event for Daniels? And I do that because it brings together two skills that I think are going to be crucial for the success of our students. The first is a sound understanding of the technologies that define the fourth industrial revolution. Whether it's AI, whether it's blockchain or the Internet of Things, here is where you start learning what these technologies are. But more importantly, you start learning about how and in what fashion they're going to shape not just the future of business, but the future of life itself. And the second skill that this showcases is an entrepreneurial and an innovative mindset. If there's anything that today's environment has taught us, it's probably that the future belongs to those who can be adaptable, flexible, and creative. Because as we've seen, life can turn on a dime. Now, I'm confident that you, as Daniel students, bringing these two skill sets together will help shape and define the future for us all. And I'm proud to see and anxious to see what that future looks like. And I just have one request as you think about shaping that future. Please remember the vision statement for Daniels, pioneering business for the public good. Please remember all of those segments of society less fortunate than yourselves who may not have a say in shaping what that future looks like. Now, before we move on to the competition itself, let me start first by thanking the Madden family for their generous and sustained financial support of this competition. Obviously, without this very generous support, this competition would not be possible. So thank you very much. Next, let me thank all the judges that have so generously given of their time this evening. I know that all of the students will benefit from your input and from your feedback. Last but not least, I want to congratulate all of the students here today. I know that this is the most unusual of terms, but in spite of all the challenges of not being able to come together as a physical group, in spite of the necessity that all of your coordination and all of your teamwork had to be done remotely, whether it's doing the market research, whether it's developing the website, whether it's coming up with the investor pitch, or with the pitch video that all of us are going to see shortly, you all have accomplished a tremendous amount. And regardless of the results of the competition that is about to unfold, you are all winners. You should all be proud of what you've accomplished and the work that you're about to present. I certainly am. And so congratulations to all of you again. And I hope that someday, maybe in the near future or a few years from now, one of you will be a unicorn and I will be proud to say, you know, I was there when they first conceived of this idea. So with that, all the best to all of the participants today, and let the competition begin. Joshua?
Thanks, Dean. We appreciate it. Eloquent as usual. This event has many moving parts and requires help and dedication from a number of people. Throughout the evening, I want to recognize a number of the people that helped make this event happen. First, I'd like to introduce a talented team that I get to work with every day in the Office of Entrepreneurship. Rosanna, Ashley, Gressy, and Ronnie. Gressy and Ronnie are the backbone of our social media team, and we'll be posting throughout the event tonight. Spring quarter was definitely unique for students and professors around the country and around the world. We went online right before spring break. This was a huge change and required a new approach to the Madden Challenge project. We had 21 teams across four sections in the Fourth Industrial Revolution course. They were tasked with identifying a problem, an unmet need, or an opportunity, and using one or more of the six core Fourth Industrial Revolution technologies to solve the problem, address the unmet need, or capitalize on the opportunity. The Internet of Things, artificial intelligence, extended reality, distributed ledger, blockchain, cryptocurrency, autonomous vehicles and drones, additive manufacturing, also known as 3D printing. These teams spent a total of 5 weeks developing this idea with one goal: convincing potential investors to invest in their innovation, invest in their idea. Oh, and one small change from previous quarters, from the winter quarter, from the fall quarter. Each team was going to spend the next 5 weeks working on this project remotely. There was no in-person meetings with team members. Teams were required to identify the best process and tools to communicate and collaborate virtually, dealing with different time zones, personalities, and work habits. Very impressive. I believe the end product speaks volumes about the creativity, motivation, and tenacity of each of these teams represented tonight. Up here on the screen is a quote from Klaus Schwab on the Fourth Industrial Revolution. Tonight, you're going to watch pitches that use Fourth Industrial Revolution technologies. The judges will score based on the following criteria. Was the problem, need, opportunity clearly articulated by the team? Was there a clear and succinct overview of the innovation and how it solved the problem or meets the need and opportunity? And finally, the third one, was the target market clearly defined? And was it clearly articulated how the target market engages with the idea? Audience, you're included tonight as well. You will also have the opportunity to weigh in tonight. At the conclusion of the final pitch, the seventh pitch, you will vote on the best pitch. So as you're watching the seven pitches, your criteria is, what is the best, most polished pitch? What is the one that makes you want to invest in this company, in this idea? Let's meet the judges. It is my pleasure to introduce our seven judges for tonight's event. All very accomplished. You will have the opportunity to hear from the judges later in the evening. Our first judge, Kenitha Hang Snow. She is assistant director of Project Excite at the University of Denver. She supports student entrepreneurs in thinking big and taking their ideas to the next level. Clark Reed is the head of trading and portfolio risk at Shapeshift, an internationally renowned cryptocurrency trading platform based here in Denver, Colorado. Before joining Shapeshift, Clark spent over a decade building a career at a Wall Street giants like Lehman Brothers, Barclays Capital, and Credit Suisse. Clark graciously volunteered to come speak at one of my blockchain cryptocurrency classes this quarter. He was scheduled for an hour, but the students loved him so much, it took up the entire 2 hours. John Carpenter is a DU alum and is the chief operating officer of Pinnacle Cart and Prupay, and is the co-founder of the widely acclaimed Global Blockchain Summit. Dana Giddens has more than 20 years of experience in IT management, software development, and startups. She's a dynamic leader, and she is currently pursuing her MBA at the University of Denver and strategically planning the launch of her next startup. Someone we all know and needs very little introduction is Dr. Stephen Haig, professor of the practice in the Daniels College of Business, Department of Business Information and Analytics. Andrew Warren has worked with many technology companies focused on their go-to-market and large, mid-sized, and early-stage and venture-backed startups, mainly around security and storage. And David Deal, he is a partner at 1-7 Advisors, a tax and family office advisory firm in Fort Collins, Colorado. These are our seven judges. Welcome, judges, and thank you for spending your evening with us. Truly appreciate it. Okay, let's meet the teams. Here are the seven teams for tonight. Each team has created a 6 to 7 minute pitch video, which I'll play for you. At the conclusion of each pitch video, the judges will have 2 to 3 minutes for question and answer. Each team has one team member representing them. At the conclusion of the seven pitch videos, the judges will leave us for about 20 minutes, go to another Zoom room to select the winning team. During that time, we have a very special guest speaker that will present while the judges are deliberating. Judges, once each pitch video has concluded, please turn on your microphones and cameras for the Q&A and raise your physical hand in to ask questions. Well, I'm really excited. Let's get started. Our first team is the Elements. Team members, Sophie, Murphy, Jackson, and James. They're coming from Denver, Corvallis, Minneapolis. Jackson will handle the team's Q&A. Okay, judges, I'm going to cue up the video.
Did you know that roughly 2.3 million guitars are sold every year in the United States? Now imagine that the instrument you bought is no longer able to be used because of humidity damage. That is why we created the Quarantool Smart Case. This system is an Internet of Things device that protects your musical instrument. With the environmental control system, you can control the humidity level, the temperature, the pressure, and even lock your case, all from your phone.
Before hit into the issue, let's see if you met a situation like this. For wood instrument, they could be easily affected by external environment. There are two typical factors, temperature and relative humidity. The best way to test if your instrument is under good condition or not is to look at a general appearance. The easiest way to do that is to put a ruler above the surface just like this. You can see if it's uneven, flat, or not. The truth is that a lot of musicians may never realize that this could be a huge issue. If we test both inside and outside relative humidity using a hypergrammeter, you'll find out that the humidity level could have unstable change even within a single day in the same place. One of the biggest guitar manufacturers, the Taylor, given the data that the best humidity level matched between 45 to 55%. But there are only a few areas in the US are within this level. Yes, you could get a new one anytime, but to those who regard their instrument as priceless treasure, or those who need to give tournament performance. This is undoubtedly a catastrophe. That's why we came out our smart case.
We calculated that the two major guitar companies in the United States, Martin and Taylor, sell well over 220,000 guitars a year, and that there are over 4 million of their guitars out in the world right now. All of these guitars need to be humidified. With the smart case, we are targeting touring male artists that are between the ages 25 and 50 years old. 90% of guitarists are male. With the age range of 25 to 50, we are targeting a group of people that have the money and experience playing to buy a higher-end guitar. Additionally, the smart case is great for touring artists that are going from one environment to another. They make up a smaller population, but they tend to own more than one guitar, and they need to keep their instruments in a steady, controlled environment when traveling, as well as keep it safe. We are targeting a smaller market by focusing on acoustic guitars. However, we will be able to grow because of all the wood instruments that need to be in a controlled environment. Some of these include cello, violin, viola, harp, stand-up bass, and even pianos.
The smart case employs a growing technology called the Internet of Things, or IoT. IoT is the concept of connecting physical devices to the internet through data that sensors on the device generate. The sensors built into the smart case include a humidistat, pressure sensor, thermometer, and location tracker. Data from these sensors is sent to IoT software, which relays information to the user, saves data, and makes decisions based on remote user input. These decisions are executed by a built-in humidifier and dehumidifier, adjustable heating and cooling plates, and a digital locking mechanism. These are powered by a combination of rechargeable batteries and solar cells to maximize portability. The result is a portable instrument case that monitors and controls the environment, notifies users when attention is needed, tracks location, and locks from an app. Not only does the smart case provide these functionalities, but it provides another valuable resource, data. Once we have collected and correlated environmental data, machine learning can be utilized to recognize patterns. Machine learning is the process of training a computer to think the way humans can. By using machine learning, we can create predictive algorithms that will warn users of high-risk environments before they even happen. This will give us a head start in applying IoT to other industries. These industries could include shipping and supply chains, food delivery, healthcare, agriculture, and much more.
From market research, we have determined that the age of our market is mostly between the ages of 20 and 30 and tend not to humidify their instruments. This is surprising because many of those surveyed had instruments over $1,000, so people are generally buying relatively expensive instruments and not taking care of them properly. A good way to reach this market might be through online guitar stores, where we could place ads near cases or promote our product listings, and physical guitar stores, where we could place ads or the product near guitar cases. Our survey also found that over 60% of respondents preferred to purchase instruments in boutique stores versus a little over 40% preferring corporate stores like Guitar Center. We had originally thought that online advertising would be effective, but the data suggests from our survey that only 20% shop online and that the majority say they've never seen music-related ads online or were not affected by the advertisements.
The two main competitors on the market are the Humidipak and the Sponge Humidifier. The Humidipak is designed to maintain a specific humidity by both releasing and absorbing moisture. However, it does not measure the true humidity within the case. It also requires $12 per month in replacement packs. The Sponge Humidifier is cheaper but less effective. Although it can humidify the instrument, you never know if it is humidifying too much or too little. It also does not have the ability to dehumidify. Lastly, the sponge must be refilled with distilled water daily and risks damaging the instrument with leaking water drops. Room humidification is another option, but it is not portable and it requires the living space to be impacted.
We hope you've enjoyed watching our video and would love to have your support in taking this idea to market. Thank you.
Bridges, please turn on your cameras. Do we have any questions for Jackson and the elements? Yes, Stephen Haig, please go ahead.
Hey, love to lead off. All right, team, I love it. Obviously, I probably look like I'm in a rock and roll band. So thank you very much for taking care of our instruments. Here's my question to you. Given everything that you're talking about, which is a humidity system, rechargeable batteries, solar panels, a dehumidification process, it would probably include a motor and all of that kind of stuff. Have you done any sort of estimates about the additional weight that you're going to add to a traditional case in order to bring this innovation to market?
Yes, we have thought through that a bit, and that's a really good point, and it's something that we've considered. I think one thing we thought about is one proof of concept is that the sponge humidifier option and the humidipack option, both of those are quite small. So that's obviously taking care of only the water reservoir, but that just shows us that it really doesn't take that much water to provide the humidity we need. It's such a small volume of the case that you would only need a very small fan. And I don't really suspect electrical engineering background. I don't suspect you need much more than a few nine volt batteries to that would be rechargeable batteries to make this happen. Another thing is that guitar cases have they're designed where you can have the balance point work so that where the majority of the weight for like the heavier electronics could be placed at the very point where you have the handle. So that will help help with the weight not being awkward.
So again, really quickly, Jax, are you saying 2 pounds, 4 pounds?
Yeah.
Pound and a half? Where are we?
I think I wouldn't suspect more than 5 pounds.
More than five. Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Questions from other judges.
I had a question around price. Did you establish an MSRP for this particular product, or was that not part of what the job required?
John, yeah, that one thing is that there will be no price and costing within
okay,
the 5 weeks.
Okay, great to know.
Dana, you had your hand up. Go ahead, please.
I do. Yeah. Gang, question, have you broken out the overall scope of market between guitars versus violins versus the other area that you are looking to expand to? Is I'm assuming that you started with guitars because it's the largest market, but I'm just curious if you scoped out the kind of the full realm of what's possible in terms of the market.
We didn't get to the thanks for that question first, but we didn't get to the point of getting a specific number for the size of the market. But yeah, we're really kind of trying to focus on the guitar market. We were able to find that there's, you know, the 4 million guitars out there now. And then kind of if we can focus in on that, that will allow us to be able to find out a lot more information on the viability of this product. And gather more data. That's another huge value of the IoT software, is we'll gather the environmental data. And then I think at that point, we should do a little bit more research into how much we can expand. I think in total, if I had to guess it, you could probably get about double the size when you include acoustic, upright bassists, violinists, and all of it.
Okay.
Okay, and we'll take our final question from David Deal.
I wondered if you considered going to a higher end of the market in terms of instrument value. My impression would be that violins and bass and some of the orchestra instruments are maybe where people are truly concerned about preserving the instrument versus guitar owners that my impression, at least from a son who plays guitar, is he's always interested in his next one.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I think that it's really a size thing with when we looked at the market for violin owners or more expensive orchestra instruments, it would be hard to narrow in on our market enough in those circumstances because it's a small market. So we would need to be spreading our net, so to speak, with lots of different types of instruments. And the target market for an upright bassist would actually be a lot different than a violinist. And we want to be able to make sure we can target our market specifically. In market research, we also did find that the majority spent between $1,000 and $10,000 on their guitar. So, and also we found that 18%, nearly one fifth, would be willing to pay $1,000 or more to fix their guitar. So we are finding that guitar owners do care enough about their instrument where this is an issue for them.
Great.
Jackson, thank you very much. Judges, please take 30 seconds to write down your scores, and then we'll move to the next team. Audience, I forgot to mention there is a Q&A function. If you want to ask questions of each team, please do so, and we'll try to get to them. Okay, our next team is Canopy. Team members Hannah, Sophie, Bella, Kwong, and Alex, coming from Denver, Glenwood Springs, and Milwaukee. Hannah will be handling the Q&A tonight for Canopy. Judges, I'm going to start the video now.
Did you know that 1 in 5 Americans will develop skin cancer?
He was born in the summer of his 27th year, coming home to a place he'd never been before. He left yesterday behind him, you might say he was born again. You might say
Canopy, take control of your skin, take control of your life. In the United States, 1 in 5 Americans will develop skin cancer. It is estimated by the Skin Cancer Foundation that 9,500 people in the U.S. are diagnosed with skin cancer every day. More than 2 people die of skin cancer every hour. Our augmented reality clip and app, Canopy, aims to decrease your risk of developing skin cancer as you age. According to our survey, about 90% of respondents spend about 3 hours in the sun every day, but about 55% said they wear sunscreen less than 3 times a week or only in the summer. Our product will change your everyday routine in just the right way to create a better future for your skin and life. By using an SPF of 15 or higher, your risk of skin cancer can be reduced by 66% for men and 75% for women. When detected early, the 5-year survival rate for melanoma is 99%. Our app aims to create life-changing habits. Canopy is an augmented reality skincare app that makes caring for your skin simple and accessible from anywhere. After downloading Canopy from the App Store, the user will be asked a series of questions that relate to their age, gender, location, occupation, skin history, and sun exposure. This information will be processed to understand their risk of skin cancer. Our customers will be given a clip-on filter to place over their phone's camera, creating a safe ultraviolet scan that utilizes augmented reality to show your sun damage in real time. They will then receive a specifically curated subscription box with sunscreen, serums, moisturizers, and other skincare products. If the user likes a specific product we offer, they can request it in future boxes. Not only do our customers receive subscription boxes every 2 months, but our app is designed to help the user implement these new items into their daily routine to create those life-changing habits. We are targeting Colorado women and men ages 30 to 50, about 30% of Colorado's population. Colorado is widely known for its 300 days of sunshine every year. This can have a great impact on people's skin. When compared to sea level, Colorado's UV exposure can be around 20% higher on average because of the high elevation. We also have a significantly active and outdoorsy population. Approximately 92% of Coloradans participate in outdoor recreation 4 times a week or at least every few weeks. Also, Colorado has the lowest rate of obesity in the country at 23%. Considering these factors, it is clear that Coloradans care about the outdoors, healthy habits and prevention, and an overall quality of life, which highlights that Colorado would be a great place to start Canopy. Our survey showed 90% of our respondents spend up to 3 hours in the sun every day, but 55% said they wear sunscreen less than 3 times a week or only in the summer. Our survey also showed 33% of people never go to the dermatologist, and 37% only go when they have a specific problem. The lack of general skincare in a state that has one of the highest exposures to the sun, more people outside, and 300 days of sunshine illustrates how beneficial our app could be to Coloradans and their skin. Because an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. Our survey shows 83% of our respondents have never used an ultraviolet scan to see their underlying skin damage, and 96% would be willing to change their habits if they could see said underlying skin damage. This is where Canopy comes in. The users put the Canopy clip over their phone's camera to create the UV scan. Within the app, your regular front or back-facing camera will utilize augmented reality to display underlying skin damage or problem areas on your phone in real time. Canopy's top three competitors are UM Skin Check, Skin Vision, and ASA. These apps take photos and assess areas that are potentially cancerous. These are all different from our product as they do not have the add-on UV scan that shows you your skin damage in real time. They also do not offer a subscription box, so they may assess potential skin cancers, but they do not offer any kind of prevention measures. Their main goal is to find pre-existing cancer, whereas Canopy aims to prevent it. Canopy's subscription box will come 6 times throughout the calendar year and is $15 per month. We are first targeting online distribution. Facebook would get us significant online traffic. In the US, the average Facebook user is 40 and a half years old, directly in the middle of our target market. We also want to partner with large department stores like Macy's or Nordstrom to display our product on their website, because 54% of online shoppers say they subscribe to a subscription box service. We also plan to partner with skincare and sunscreen brands for their product lines in our subscription boxes. In turn, they can advertise the Canopy clip and our app on their websites. We also plan to continue expansion through partnering with dermatologists in Colorado. Canopy refers customers to partner dermatologists if they need consulting, have concerns about skin cancer, or need next steps for prevention. In turn, dermatologist offices would recommend Canopy and hand out our Canopy clip when they check out. It is important to our business to stay knowledgeable and accurate in what we offer our clients, so working closely with dermatologists would allow us to best take care of our customers and their skin. Canopy, take control of your skin, take control of your life.
Judges, please turn on your mics and your video. Hannah will be answering questions for Canopy. Please raise your virtual hands if you have a question. Andrew Warren, go ahead, please.
Yes, great presentation. I wanted to ask the question, how do you decide which companies do you want to partner with, you know, to kind of think about which products you want to put in those bi-weekly boxes or bi-monthly?
Sorry, you cut out at the end. What was the end of your question?
Is how do you decide who you're partnering with? You know, because when you think of the products that are going into the box that are going out to your customers, I think is an important aspect.
Yeah, thank you. That is a great question. So considering we're going to be working with dermatologists as well, there are several skincare brands that dermatologists already recommend that are great for your skin and are backed by dermatologists. And so by working closely with those types of skincare brands, Canopy would be high end and offer our clients the best items for their skin.
Good, thank you.
Kanitha.
Hi, Hannah. Great job. I have one question for you about the Canopy clip and what it's compatible with. So does it work with any device?
Yes, so we thought about this. And so what we would plan on doing is on our website, through our app, you can choose specific clips for a certain phone. But what we've already been thinking of is that the clip should work on almost every phone.
Dana, go ahead, please.
Yes, Hannah, quick question. Have you done any research on what the attrition rate is kind of in general on subscription models? I know it's very popular right now, but I'm just curious as if you know kind of what you can expect in terms of turnover and requiring new customer base each turning over period.
Yeah, thank you. That's a good question. So what we found is that people who shop online, 54% actually subscribe to a subscription box. And so based off of that information, we feel like there would be a pretty consistent amount of people who are subscribing.
Okay, do we have any other questions from the judges? Oh, Clark, please go ahead.
I was just curious to hear more about your survey. How did you conduct it and what were the metrics around everything?
Thank you, good question. So we decided to focus on putting our survey on Facebook and Instagram because that's kind of the age range we were going for. And so we know that most of our responses were from Coloradans. And so we asked age, occupation, how often you're spending time in the sun and whether or not you're wearing sunscreen. And then based off of that data, we found some very interesting conclusions. And then at the very end, we ask, have you ever had your face or any other part of your body scanned by any kind of UV light, like at a dermatologist? And a lot of people haven't, but 96% said that if they could and if they could see that skin damage, they would be willing to change their habits. And so that only furthered our want and need to make Canopy more of a reality.
Wonderful. Hold on one second. I think we have one question off of the audience, a Koa flag. Where do you plan on starting with the product?
Colorado.
Okay. And one other from Milan, is the price of the subscription box dependent on what products are inside, or is it a static price?
It is a static price, so it would be $15 per box. So every 2 months, you would be charged $15.
Excellent. Hey, Hannah, thank you very much. Judges, take a few minutes, or about 30 seconds, pardon me, to score Canopy, please, and I'll set us up for the next presentation, video pitch.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next team is Plant Parent, coming from Sacramento, Kansas City, Miami Beach, Colorado, and Washington, D.C. Team members are Tony, Liv, Michael, Samantha, and Joshua. Joshua will be handling the Q&A tonight for Plant Parent. Judges, get ready. I'm going to queue up the video.
This is Barry, your run-of-the-mill house bamboo plant. Barry is pretty low maintenance. He just needs fresh water, lots of indirect sunshine, and clean air. Look, I even got him a humidifier. Unfortunately, however, I seem to have some sort of plant curse on me which kills every plant I touch, and some of Barry's leaves are starting to brown. This is terrifying because he's not even my bamboo plant. He's Zoe's, my girlfriend. Now, Zoe loves two things in this world, me and her plant, and she will be very mad at me if I kill her bamboo. So I got to thinking, why isn't there a device which connects to my phone and lets me know what I'm doing wrong? With a few powerful sensors and a solid database, you could easily access plant vitals and report back with suggestions on how to improve plant care. It's from these ideas that we came up with a Plant Parent, a solar-powered Internet of Things device with the potential to save millions of lives, plant lives, that is, from people like me.
Plant Parent is a new, innovative product that has created a way in which millennials can better take care of their plant children. Because what the future will bring is widely unknown, especially given the current world circumstances and complicated times, Plant Parent gives you the opportunity to grow a family without the fear or worry of what comes next. This is a significantly lower financial and time investment that also brings a lot of fun and new challenges and opportunities to learn and connect with nature on such a unique level of sophisticated programming. Just like us, plants are living creatures that need love, attention, and nutrients. Plant Parent will allow for you to create a lush garden in the convenience of inside or outside of your own home. While many plant sensors measure moisture levels within the soil, Plant Parent has been designed so that it accurately measures humidity and sunlight and pH and fertilizer levels with our innovative, eco-friendly solar-powered tool. Plant Parent sends you a direct notification reminding you to water your plant and whether or not it needs more or less water, sunlight, and/or nutrients. Here at Plant Parent, we strive to better the environment by limiting the use of non-reusable resources and non-recyclable products. By doing our part to protect the ever-changing climate, we provide raw material to the manufacturer so that they can create a product made from recycled plastics and glass.
Our product is perfect for millennials, especially those who live in cities and don't have families. Because it's so hard for millennials to own a home right now, many choose to care for plants instead of start a family or own pets. Many even call themselves plant parents instead of dog, dad, or cat mom.
Our product simplifies plant care and taps into millennials' emotional connection to their plants. With our product, millennials will never commit plant murder again. In addition to easing loneliness, plants are shown to boost mood, productivity, concentration, and creativity. However, 47% of millennials surveyed don't currently own plants because they don't know how to take care of them. Plant Parent streamlines plant care and allows more millennials to benefit from plant ownership. On the upstream, our sensors collect and track data on your plant's well-being. The main sensor stick inside of the pot measures your plant's water level, pH levels, and soil acidity. The part of the sensor that stays above ground measures the area's humidity and has a camera to compare the look of your plant to the way the ideal plant should look based on images gathered through the internet. The detachable solar sensor has solar panels that measure the amount and strength of the sunlight your plant receives. Those solar sensors also use the light energy collected to power all of the Bluetooth-connected sensors. Inside of our app, the sensors connect to a weather app through the Internet of Things to predict when your plant will need, for example, more or less water based on predicted weather patterns. On the downstream, our devices send the data collected to the app and analyze it to give you suggestions about how you should best care for your plant by comparing your plant's data to the ideal conditions for your type of plant. The app could suggest to give your plant more sunlight or water, or to add a type of fertilizer that would increase or decrease the acidity of the soil. Through the app and your plant's profile, it will seem as though your plants are talking directly to you. A notification will pop up on your phone from the plant you named, with them telling you their needs.
Our competition has an impressive list of what their sensors are capable of. However, they all measure different aspects of the plant, whereas our sensors will contain aspects from all of our competitors, which will allow for a fuller and more clear path to care for your plant. Companies such as Parrot Pot only assist the owner in watering the plant. It does not give the owner information as to what is happening. The company FYTA gives information about the sunlight and will tell the owner when it needs more or less, but lacks the ability to tell the user exactly what nutrients are missing from the soil. We will set out to give the owner a full spectrum of exactly what your plant needs and does not need in the easiest, low-maintenance system as possible.
Because we are targeting millennials, we are marketing our product on Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, and Snapchat. Millennials do most of their shopping online, and a large percent of millennials are active on social media. With more than 83.1 million millennials in the United States alone, the millennial generation is responsible for owning 80% of the total number of houseplants and are the main reason for the massive growth in the market we have been seeing in the past year. Creating an eye-catching and attractive ad for social media will attract our target market. Our product comes in sizes small, medium, large, and extra large, with affordable prices ranging from $30 to $40 and a solar panel for $15. The app that is connected to our product requires a subscription for $5 a month. We also have an online shop with customizable nameplates and signs for the plants in order to maximize the consumer experience with our product.
The Plant Parent is a device which has the potential to improve life on this planet. A product unlike anything on the market now, and monitors every conceivable factor contributing to your plant's health. The software reports back to you, keeping it fun and engaging, which certainly works for our consumer base. But the product potential is so much greater. Each time you breathe, you should be thanking the leaves of this world. Without them, none of us could be here. The Plant Parent aims to give something back to these plants. Every one of our devices has the goal of sustaining plant life, which will serve to create a thriving worldwide ecosystem. We hope you'll support that mission.
Who has a question for Joshua? Stephen Haig, please.
Thank you.
Michael.
No problem.
Michael, and looking at your pricing model, if you go on the high end to the big one and the $5 a month, I think, subscription and the solar panel, looking at, somewhere in the neighborhood of a first year cost of $120 to $150 to your consumer, did you do any target market research with respect to how much they would be willing to pay? $150 first year cost seems high. Did you ask your target market about that?
Yes, sir. In our survey, we went ahead and put out pricing models, and people were very much willing to pay easily $50 to $100 for just the model itself. But we went ahead and cut back pricing to add the subscription-based fee to it. And that's not uncommon, especially amongst these plant owners that we're targeting. There's a lot of companies that kind of follow the subscription blue model apron, where you can get a plant in the mail. And those companies, there's at least easily a dozen of them, but their prices range from $12 to $70 a month. And so there's a huge consumer base for the people that really care about their plants and for the people that are trying to keep them alive to pay for this service.
Thank you, Michael.
Mm-hmm, happy to.
David Dio, please go ahead.
Did you guys give any consideration to developing some sort of ranking system as people improve with plants? It sounds like you got feedback that your target market takes seriously the emotional connection with your plant. Would they get any additional satisfaction by having some sort of improved status ranking for how they do with it?
Oh, we hadn't thought about a ranking system letting you know how well your plants are doing, but the feedback from the plants is going to be very personalized. So in the video, there was like the little graphic that was like, hey, can we go outside today? It'll be stuff like that. You can name your plants when you first get on the software, and you'll get texts from them, essentially. Like in my case, it would be from Barry. It'd be like, hey, I'm kind of thirsty. Or could I get a little more sunlight, please? So you develop that personal relationship, and it will help you connect more emotionally.
John Carpenter, go ahead, please.
Yeah, Michael. Have you given any thought to partnering with any of the houseplant sellers to provide a QR code when someone buys a houseplant that you could automatically load the data into your app?
Oh, that's an incredible idea. We actually hadn't considered that yet, but that's because we're planning on starting with online marketing and online sales first, but the expansion into those plant stores is the next step. And that would be a perfect way to do it, to partner up with the plant manufacturers.
Tanitha, go ahead, please.
Michael, so does the sensor work on outdoor plants as well?
Yes, it does. We're planning on making this for indoor and outdoor use. So gardeners outside to amateurs like me could hypothetically use this and improve their plants.
We have a question from the audience. I love the audience engagement. From Alan, can more than one sensor be linked to a single account?
Yes, that's a huge part of this. On our website, we're going to be selling them in packs for your initial purchase. You can just get one, but once you have the software, you can add as many devices as you want, essentially. We plan on making that very scalable. And one of the reasons for our subscription fee is because our sensors are designed with longevity in mind, and we don't expect on ever really replacing those. So once you get a sensor, if your plant dies, hopefully it wouldn't, but plants get old, you could even transfer it to a different plant, rename that sensor, and then use it on something else. But yeah, they'll work on multiple plants.
Wonderful. Okay, that's all the time we have for Plant Parent. Michael, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much.
Please score Plant Parent, and we'll get set up for the next group. Okay, our next team is Bird's Eye Media, coming from Sacramento, Kansas City, Miami Beach, Colorado, and Washington, D.C. Team members are Victoria, Charles, Ben, Dylan, and Annie. Dylan will be handling the Q&A tonight for Bird's Eye Media.
Over the past decade, the home buying experience has changed completely with the introduction of online home buying and selling platforms. The house hunting process has become more digitalized than ever. Yet, according to a 2018 study by the National Association of Realtors, 48% of firms claim that keeping up with technology is one of the biggest challenges their firm will face in the next 2 years. Firms that have been trying to keep up with the new digital wave of home buying have seen the benefits. Research has shown that professionally photographed homes sell 32% faster than homes that aren't. A home with one photo spends an average of 70 days on the market, while a home with 20 photos spends an average of 32 days on the market. The new frontier in the online home buying experience is drone tours and video tours with the ability to interact with the property in real time. Home buyers with the use of live video tours with a real estate agent could be provided with all the information available at an open house, all from the comfort of their own home. With the ability to virtually walk customers through properties, houses could sell faster and for higher price tags to clients across the globe.
We understand the frustration that comes with trying to list your first house. Our drone service will increase listing price while showing off your property's greatest features. We will first plan on purchasing multiple DJI Mavic 2s. Our service will provide a live stream of the property, and once this is complete, one of our trained employees will edit the footage and send it to the client. But throughout this entire process, we will always have our clients' requests in front so that we can ensure that they have the most customizable experience.
Our company will focus its attention on four major cities on the West Coast, and these cities will be Los Angeles, Las Vegas, Seattle, and Denver. And we have chosen these cities because they are all in close proximity to our current location in Denver, along with the fact that they have extremely high foreign real estate investment. We will partner with major international real estate companies such as RE/MAX, Keller Williams, and Coldwell Banker. And we will partner with smaller brokerages from these major companies in key locations in the four major cities we want to target. Los Angeles will be our biggest market as it is estimated to have over $2.5 billion of foreign real estate investment annually. Target partner would be a real estate company who wants to stand out from the crowd by being on the bleeding edge of technology. By using our service, they'd be able to live stream property tours to clients no matter where they live. Not only does it allow for an increase in client reach, but it also can save the client thousands of dollars because they can tour property from the comfort of their own home. A seller would also be able to use our service if they want to make their listing stand out from the rest. Not only that, but it is estimated that homes below $1 million can increase the amount of money a buyer spends by $3,000 to $11,000 because of high-quality video and photos.
We want the process of accessing these services to be as easy as possible for our clients. That's why we plan to partner with real estate firms and agencies to be their drone service provider, connecting both home buyers and home sellers with drones through a common medium. This will reduce the amount of marketing we need to do in order to reach our clients. The agency representatives will be incentivized to market our services to the clients as professional drone photography can add value to homes. Clients buying homes will have the option to request drone photos and live virtual tours, which will increase their home buying satisfaction and save time in the decision-making process. We also offer the same great services outside the partnership of real estate firms, giving home buyers and sellers the options of using our products without going through listing agencies. Where we differentiate ourselves from competitors is our live broadcasting to share drone footage anywhere in the world, providing an immersive home buying experience that can only be supplemented with an in-person visit. Imagine being able to view a home from spectacular angles, inside and out, highlighting property features and scale has never been so easy. We plan to have multiple drone pilots in each of our beginning markets. The service requests will be made to our B2C or B2B platforms. From there, a drone pilot will travel to a listing and set up a drone, which takes less than 15 minutes. From there, they will take the requested videos or photos, or if it's a virtual tour, they will connect their controller to a computer, which will broadcast a signal. Afterwards, the footage is processed and edited to the package specification.
For our company, Bird's Eye Media, our packages run between $200 and $2,500. Our starting package starts at $500 and includes three high-resolution aerial photos of the property. We also have an economy package for $200. Next, our pro package, running $700, includes five high-resolution aerial photos and 2 minutes of edited video drone footage. Our $850 Pro Plus package includes 10 high-resolution aerial photos and 5 minutes of edited video, along with a 10-minute live tour of the property. Finally, our most expensive Platinum package, running $2,500, includes 10 aerial photos, 5 minutes of video, and a 15-minute live tour. In the market of drone real estate filming and editing, we have many competitors, such as HouseLens, DroneBase, Sold by Air, and many more. Bird's Eye Media sets itself apart from its competitors by making drone tours of properties more interactive through our live streaming option, allowing realtors to walk their clients through the properties being toured in real time online.
Judges, please turn on your video. Who has a question for Bird's Eye Media? Oh, Andrew, please go ahead.
So you talked about Los Angeles being a large foreign buyer's market. How did the other markets kind of stack up in that aspect as well? Which would be your kind of next best market and from there?
Thank you. I would say the next best market would be Seattle. But otherwise, they're not as high on foreign investment. Los Angeles is definitely the highest.
Great, thanks.
Dana, go ahead, please.
Hey, Dylan. So you're proposing that this would be the fees would be paid by the homeowner, or the fees would be paid by the real estate agent as a differentiating factor for signing up with a specific real estate agent? Who's handling the costs?
Thank you, Dana. So it depends on whether or not the client is going through a real estate agency or firm, because we allow it to where we are partnering with real estate agencies and firms. And so in that way, so let's say a home buyer, a home seller learns about our service through the real estate agency. The real estate agency would take the cost, and then the buyer or the seller would be charged. And then if it's directly to the consumer, and so if they're buying or selling without a firm, then they would be taking that cost.
Other questions from the judges? Kanitha, go ahead, please.
So it sounds like one of the big differentiators between you and your competitors is the live stream component. Did you conduct any market research about why that live stream component is important?
Yeah, so the live stream component enables people from anywhere in the world to view the homes, and they can actually view the homes with the drones inside and out. And so they can do an aerial shot of the backyard, and then they can swoop in into the driveway and then go into the front door, and you can see all the rooms. And why that's such a crucial component is because no one else from our research is doing that. This is a new technology that enables to do it, and right now it's only being segmented towards like the entertainment sector. Did that answer your question?
We have a question from an anonymous attendee in the audience. Since the real estate agents are generally freelance to some extent, wouldn't the clients be the agencies themselves?
No. So we plan to, when we say we're the drone service provider for the agency, like just as Remax, they have their own drone service company, and Bird's Eye Media, we would be the same. And so, I mean, we could work with a real estate representative who does freelance work, but we would be the company's drone provider. We wouldn't be an individual's drone provider if it's just an individual representative.
Excellent. Audience, keep those questions coming. We appreciate it. Dylan, thank you very much for your time. Well done.
Thank you.
Judges, please score, and I will get the next pitch video set up. Our next team is the planners, coming from Palatine, Denver, Miami, and Portland. Team members are Alex, Kai, Gabby, and Allie. Allie Johnson will be handling the Q&A portion of the presentation.
Why do we need the Pulse Planner? Life is more hectic than ever, and planning daily schedules is becoming more difficult as a result. 54% of adults ranging in age from 18 to 29 say they frequently feel extremely busy, and school life is cited as one of the main sources of this. Growing workloads lead to procrastination, and our survey of DU students reflects this, with 58% saying they procrastinate when they don't have a lot of time to work. So what is it? Pulse Planner is an all-new calendar technology used either in the app or the browser that designs a unique schedule for the user based on their individual needs and individual schedule. How does it work? Two processes drive our product's planning. The first is artificial intelligence. With AI, Pulse Planner can think just like a human would thanks to a pre-programmed algorithm focusing on the ways people plan, plus a lengthy test given to the user using established Myers-Briggs personality typing to know exactly what they might need, ensuring Pulse Planner can create a custom schedule right out of the box. The second process, machine learning, allows Pulse Planner to study how the user manages their time compared to what it expected. Over time, machine learning ensures that Pulse Planner can create schedules that meet the exact needs of every user. These processes are constantly interacting with the user in order to improve their experience, chiefly by a nightly questionnaire given to the user, which is shown here. Over time, the user's answers teach Pulse Planner how an individual likes to balance their time and tunes their schedule to meet these exact needs perfectly. But it doesn't stop there. The Pulse Planner incorporates a host of other features designed to enhance its ability to learn from the user and make Pulse Planner more than just a calendar. First, the task timer allows users to show Pulse Planner exactly how much time they need on different tasks. In addition, Pulse Planner can pull traffic information from navigation apps to tell the user the best time to hit the road. And finally, Pulse Planner provides the user with a preview of the next day, reminding them of upcoming tasks and how Pulse Planner split up their time.
Our overall broad target market is significantly busy males and females in the United States between the ages of 16 to 18. We would like you to note that 15.3 million students will attend grades 9 through 12, putting them at the average age of 16 to 18 years old. We'd also like you to know that 12.1 million students will attend full-time college at the average age of 18 to 30 years old. And we want to add in all of the busy families with a multitude of schedules as well. This gives us 84 million more people. And we also know that the percentage of Americans who own smartphones is 81%. We did some research of our own as well. 56% of responders ranging from 18 to 26 have more than one extracurricular activity keeping them busy, and 67% of responders in that same age range have a calendar that schedules multiple priorities for them. Taking all of these figures into account, along with our other research explained in the upcoming slides, our overall broad target market size will be around 11.8 million significantly busy males and females in the United States between the ages of 16 to 35. This being said, our total addressable market, or our pilot group at the moment, will be much smaller. We're hoping to start by just targeting the significantly busy and early adopting male and female undergraduate students at the University of Denver. Due to the primary statistics that we've already described, 30% of this population will be addressable, giving our target market at DU around 1,762 students. We will then slowly try to expand to other colleges and schools around Colorado as we gain profit and attention, and finally make our way to markets like busy parents, people who have problems planning, have executive functioning issues and time management issues, and of course, the busy working professionals. To understand our target market better, it's good to note these people strive for success and perfection in educational studies and in the workforce. These people might be honor degree students, student athletes, college double majors, and might be involved in multiple extracurriculars. They also could be new families who need help scheduling their day and their kids' day, or working parents juggling home and work. Or they may struggle with planning. They might have ADHD. All of these users are going to be early adopters, meaning that they're always learning how to use new technology, and they're going to have access to smartphones and computers and have a large interest in this new automatic digital organization of their schedules to help optimize their day. Our research found that 63% of students agreed that their usage of digital learning technology resulted in them being better prepared for classes, and 35% of Americans say that they like the variety of trying new digital products, and 15% say that they usually try technology products before others do. We also found that 64% of Americans held back on time to relax for themselves because of lack of certainty with personal schedules. We also found that 57% 7% held back because of uncertainty in work schedules, and 50% held back because of uncertainty in their children's schedules. It's also good to note mentally, 55% of Americans are stressed during the day, and more than 60% of college students have experienced overwhelming anxiety. We want to help bring the stress and anxiety down with the Pulse Planner. 94% of people who responded to our survey said that when they were more organized, they also felt more relaxed. And 60% say that they procrastinate when they don't have set times for things. Our goal with the Pulse Planner is to help solve the problem of time for our hardworking and busy go-getters.
Now you may think that we have a lot of competition out there with all the online calendars on the market. However, we are the only ones who interact and learn from our customers. After taking in your input every day, our algorithm will take it into account and be able to plan your next schedule even better than the last time, and continue to improve. We are also the only calendar that will intuitively plan our users' downtime, as well as providing custom notifications.
Hello everyone. For the first, we will use a content marketing strategy. I think it's a good way to increase the visual effect of our application software. When customers use our software, the page of the software is very simple because the users who use our software pursue to maximize the use of time. So it is very important to use the interface quickly and conveniently. In addition, search engine optimization is also an essential part of us. We will use the big data to integrate users' favorite search content so as to provide users with some suggestion in Post Planner every day. Furthermore, so the frequency and the content of other software customer use, integrate the most reasonable work plan and time to the customers. Certainly, the most effective solution and the most intelligent processing result are our goal.
Judges, do you have questions for Allie with the planners? Clark, please go ahead.
Hi, Allie. So my question is a product-based question. I'm wondering how much time you envision this process will take for the user to take in order to facilitate new recommendations, and then what type of recommendations do you imagine that the software will be making?
Yeah, great question. So we're hoping that this won't take too long. It's kind of like an end of the day ritual, you could say. And it's going to pull up first two questions. And it's going to say, was this successful for your day? And did everything work out well? Did you have enough time? And if it's yes to both of those questions, then it will stop there. And it will know that all of that data for that day was correct through our other parts of the actual product. But if they say no to any of those, we're hoping for like five more questions that'll come up at the end of the day. That's like, okay, did you get enough sleep? Or questions like that, which will also show like, oh, they need more time for this, or oh, they need more time getting ready in the morning. And so those will kind of help plan that. So it should take to like 5 minutes at night when you first download the product, because we're thinking this could either be an app or it could be connected to a different, like a calendar like Google. We're hoping that when you first download it, you will get a good questionnaire of like 100 questions, and it will take you some time to get through it. You can skip it, and it will slowly catch up to your personal needs. But if you do those 100 questions, it's supposed to have a better idea of who you are. We're also hoping that before we actually launch this product, we'll have a pilot group that we can use. And we will actually pay them to download all of their data into the product before we launch it. And so this way, it'll have a baseline of different types of personalities. We'll probably use, like I think it said in the video, it said we're gonna use personality style survey like the Myers-Briggs, so that it will have certain places that it will know, oh, this type of person's probably gonna need more time, or this type of person's gonna want more structure. And that'll be like the baseline. I hope that answers.
Dana, go ahead, please.
Hey, Allie. Have you guys talked at all about integrating? I like the idea of a lot of human engagement, but have you thought at all about integrating biotechnology? So basically, that would allow you to integrate the software and allow it to work with the positively booming market for wearable smart applications. So it would be able to give you feedback on your heart rate and your pulse and all of these things as an additional measure. Have you thought that far out down the road?
We have not, but that is an amazing idea. And I think that would really help because we can then figure out like how much stress a person might be under due to those like bodily functions. I think that's a great idea that we definitely could integrate. Thank you.
Any more questions for Allie? Okay. Well, Allie, thank you very much. Judges, please go ahead and score the planners and we will, I'll set up for the next team. Okay, our next team is Biotech Forever Evolving, coming from Denver, Novato, in New York City. The team members are Kira, Ali, Nick, and Jean Don. Ali will handle the Q&A for Biotech Forever Evolving. Judges, we'll get this started.
Of people have at least three risk factors for heart disease. The first being smoking, but the other two being high cholesterol and high blood pressure. Over 40% of deaths causing disease can be prevented and predicted by proper testing. With high blood pressure, death by stroke is 4 times more likely, and by heart disease is 3 times more likely. Our target market is being people between age of 40 and 50 with previously been hospitalized for their health condition. We believe that there is need for our sensors with our target market. $47.5 billion in the US has gone to the high blood pressure medical expenses. As we see the opportunity in this era, a high-tech, smart, and affordable biotech sensor is what we believe is the best way to solve this problem.
Our biotech sensor is an in-body sensor that tracks cholesterol, blood pressure, blood sugar, and oxygen levels. The sensor itself, with the aid of pre-programming and Internet of Things, collects data to give you vital levels in real time. Using computing devices, the sensor has the ability to send the data right to your phone without requiring human-to-human contact. This now means that you don't have to leave your house to go to the doctors if you believe something is wrong. With the biotech sensor, you will have the ability to check your app, which will notify you if your vital levels change. Our biotech sensor tracks 4 different vital levels, while competing devices only track 1 or 2. 52% of our primary research respondents said that if they weren't comfortable with this in-body sensor, they had family members who would be. Unlike any other sensor on the market, we've allowed for users to share their sensor data with a relative. This is so that if you're in a place where you can't check your vitals, a family member can. One of the greatest things about this biotech sensor is that it has the convenience factor. No big bulky heart monitor, no glucagon that you have to prick your finger multiple times a day to tell you what your blood sugar level is. It's an in-body sensor that you just pull out your phone and it's all there.
Our tracker uses Internet of Things to enhance our sensor's ability to send and receive data. The prototype for this chip looks similar to the birth control implant. The implantation process causes no major scarring or blood loss and takes only 25 minutes. Using a specialized syringe, the sensor is implanted under and behind the ear near the carotid artery, a major blood vessel in the neck that supplies blood to the brain. With the sensor near this artery, it is allowed access to the data that it needs to track. Because the sensor is made of rubber, its flexibility allows it to sit on your skin painlessly and move with your natural body movements. At BioTech, our number one priority is safety. This sensor does not track your location or any other information besides your vitals. Each chip is given a specific serial number, which correlates to your personal private cloud where all of your chip data will be backed up to. To access this information, you must first be invited to our app by your doctor. Then you must input your login information and serial number as a secondary security level on top of our encrypted data storage. With a medical innovation like this one, we want to get the word out about our product. We will first focus on influencer marketing. Using a famous athlete with a heart condition to sponsor our product, we will get the initial word out to the public. Once our sensor has gained some momentum, we would shift our marketing style over to search engine optimization. So whenever anyone researches a heart condition that our sensor tracks, our product will appear. Using a combination of these two marketing methods and doctor recommendations, our product should quickly gain popularity and become a leader within the medical market.
From the beginning, our target market has been people between the ages of 40 and 50 who have been previously hospitalized for their health condition. This age group is still tech savvy and is more willing to try our product due to previous medical inaccuracies. We sent out a survey to our targeted age group, and over half of our survey population had a genetic heart-related issue, and 76% said they were comfortable with the idea of biotech sensors in their body. Once we established our target market, we looked into our competitors, which are typical doctors that do blood tests or other commercial products such as Apple Watch and Fitbit. We hold a key advantage over almost all of our competitors, and that is how our product is more convenient and more accurate. Specifically, when compared to testing blood with doctors, this process can be time-consuming and inconvenient versus our instant tracking. When compared to commercial products like Apple Watch, we hold a massive price advantage and also provide more accurate results. For example, Apple Watch's method of tracking irregularities in blood pressure often leads to false alarms for heart attacks. We believe that our product will be the future of receiving fast and accurate information regarding health in order to prevent heart attacks and blood disease. With the market size of blood testing expected to grow from $53 billion in 2018 to $60 billion by 2023, we foresee that our company will be a leader in the market, and there is huge room for growth.
Please turn on your cameras and mics. Who has a question for Allie? And audience, please chime in as well using the Q&A feature. Stephen, go ahead, please.
Thank you, Joshua. Allie, to begin with, I love this, but I got a little bit of a mixed signal from your presentation and from your group. You're talking about a target market of 40 to 50 year olds. You'd had some sort of pre-existing condition related to what your sensor will do, which is fine, but it seems like your real target market is actually doctors, because even if I'm 40 to 50 and I've had a pre-existing medical condition, I can't get your services without my doctor's invite. So it seems like the doctors are the real target market here, and that being the case, I don't know that influencer marketing and SEO will be attractive to them. How do you plan to get doctors convinced to recommend their patients for your service?
So that's a great question. So we first and foremost definitely want to make this sensor available to everyone, as we definitely refined our target market to ages 50 to 60, but it is available to everyone. So I definitely think that, first for influencer marketing, we want to get our word out to around everyone. But that is a really good point. We should definitely target doctors. And I think that will work, especially with using people who have previously had heart conditions within our target market. Because if we do, if they are aware of the idea, they will bring it up to their doctors, and as well as bringing that up with like insurance companies, as they will want to cover this sensor with avoidance costs. So I guess by targeting everyone around this sensor, that hopefully we should be able to get doctors in on it. But that is a really good point that we should, in fact, primarily target doctors as our market. Thank you.
David Deal, please go ahead.
For me, the decision to implant something would be a big hurdle to get through. What do you address with removing it? If you're trying to convince me to put it in my body, how do I know how easy it is to take out if I want to?
Yeah, that's a really good question as well. So as we said, our implantation process is similar to the birth control implant. So if there's any reason that you do want this sensor removed from your body, or if it has run from its course in life, you are able to, we actually take out the sensor using the same syringe. So it will go through the same spot within your neck, and the syringe will take the sensor out, which will also cause no scarring or blood loss when that happens.
Great.
Dana, go ahead, please.
Allie, ostensibly you could be collecting, aggregating colossal amounts of data with this information. How have you, or have you guys thought about, how do you get past privacy issues? Because of all this information is so specifically tied to medical, which is extremely carefully guarded. How do you get past that wall of having so much information and what you can and can't do with it?
Yeah, that's a really great question as well. So definitely safety is a primary factor that we have to look at, because I know a lot of people will definitely be nervous about what information could, you know, get hacked or anything. So first, we will have encrypted data storage. Definitely we will need to have a lot of it, but each of it will be specific to each sensor. So to access any of that data, someone will have to access the actual serial number that is on the chip or the sensor that is inside your body. So assuming that no one is actually able to look into your body and see that serial number, they won't be able to access that encrypted data storage. Along with that, I know there are a lot of people are worried about being able to get into the app. So using that serial number again, and then also login information, will keep that data safe and secure.
Our final question is going to actually come from the audience. Phil McCarthy, who's one of the professors in the entrepreneurship program. His question is, could you add body temperature as a function, given it has become an important measure regarding health during COVID-19?
Yeah, I think that definitely is a possibility, as on our sensor, there are 4 level-based sensors on it. So because it's going to be around 1 inch, there definitely is a possibility to adding another sensor onto that chip.
Wonderful. Allie, thank you very much. Judges, please score. Biotech forever evolving. And we, I'll get set up for our final pitch video. Our final pitch video tonight comes from Team Palm. Coming from Buffalo, Hamilton, Reading, and Edina. Team members are Christian, Annabelle, Shannon, and John. Annabelle Howley will be the one that will handle the Q&A, the conclusion of the video.
We move on now to the big headline about sexual assault on college campuses.
Do more to keep women safe.
Crisis of sexual assault.
Colleges may not be doing enough.
Alarming numbers in a new national survey on sexual assaults on college campuses across the country. 1 in 4 female undergrads say they've been sexually assaulted.
You wonder, like, what resources do you have at your disposal?
We talked about issues related to sex and drugs.
But not rape.
Not enough about sexual assault.
Hi. My name is John Dempsey, and I want to introduce you to the Palm family. We are living in a crazy time right now, and college students all across America can't wait until they can go back to school. They want to be able to hang out with friends, party on the weekend, and enjoy their old daily activities. Unfortunately, for a large number of them, when they go back, it won't be a perfect experience. It is the reality that all across America, colleges face a sexual assault and harassment problem. For those that encounter these situations, it leaves them feeling helpless and alone, something no young adult should have to go through. With the Palm Bracelet, we hope to give young adults who find themselves in these situations an opportunity to reach out to friends and family so they don't feel helpless.
Unfortunately, sexual assault and harassment is very prevalent in today's society. This graph shows reported lifetime experiences of sexual assault and harassment in the United States in 2019 alone. These show the stats of women and how many have experienced different forms of sexual harassment, including verbal, cyber, physical, and sexual assault itself. 81% of the women taking the survey reported experiencing all forms of sexual harassment and assault in their lifetime. When many people think of sexual assault and harassment, they think of party culture with drinking and drugs, which is very common in many cases. However, there's also just a danger walking down the street. A survey conducted showed that 65% of women nationwide had experienced street harassment. 23% had been sexually touched, 20% had been followed by their perpetrator, and 9% had even been forced to do something sexual. As for men, only 25% had experienced street harassment. It's also shown in a survey that 84% of women said they'd experienced some kind of harassment while running that had left them feeling unsafe. When assessing these statistics, it's important to note, but also very disturbing, that among the perpetrators, 1/3 of them are recognized by the victims. 25% a friend, almost 33% a previous partner. This shows that many times these crimes of sexual assault and harassment are committed by people we've learned to love and trust. In 2015, a survey was conducted involving 21 schools and reassessed in 2019. The results showed that throughout this time, the rate of non-consensual sexual contact by physical force and inability to consent went up by 3 percentage points for undergraduate women.
To combat this issue of sexual assault and harassment, we came up with the idea of POM, the bracelet that gives you peace of mind. POM is a stainless steel bracelet covered with an elastomer, rubber-like outer layer, for a comfortable user experience. The bracelet acts as a safety device for users who are otherwise defenseless in uncomfortable or life-threatening situations. In many cases of sexual assault and harassment, the victim is unable to reach through the phone to alert friends or the authorities. The POM bracelet solves this problem because the bracelet never leaves the user's person and can be activated with the push of a button. POM is equipped with a tracking chip and has multiple alert settings that are activated through a fingerprint identification button on the side of the bracelet to prevent accidental alerts. The bracelet is connected via Bluetooth to an app that can be downloaded on all smartphones and sends out an alert to the app when triggered. When held down for 3 seconds, the bracelet sends out a notification to friends and family who have the app on their phone that the user is in danger. When held for 5 seconds, the bracelet alerts the local authorities, friends and family, and sets off an audible alarm to protect against more dangerous situations. Here are some mock-ups of what the app would look like. As you can see, you can create an account and then add contacts to your alert list and establish groups for certain situations, such as going out with friends or walking home from class or just hanging out. POM is a subtle and easy to wear bracelet to make it more discreet and allow for users to wear it with confidence.
With 36.6% of women attending college in 2019, there is a large number of women in need of POM. A staggering 23.1% of undergraduate females have reported being raped or sexually assaulted, and a countless number of women have not reported their assault, which unfortunately is common. Women ages 18 to 24 who are college students are 3 times more likely than women in general to experience sexual violence. Females of the same age who are not enrolled in a college are 4 times more likely. With this in mind, we will focus mainly on females freshmen in college, ages 17 to 19. We will target women who go out an average of 2 times a week and attend a 4-year university. We will also target the women who already wear bracelets regularly and value the functionality of them. We found that over 70% of women we surveyed already wore bracelets daily and that those bracelets serve more than one purpose.
POM uses the Internet of Things to transmit location and alert signals from the bracelet to the user's app, and then the user's app to the apps of family and friends. The Internet of Things is the interconnection of devices, enabling them to send and receive data with no human interaction. The bracelet utilizes upstream data traffic for alert signals that are sent out from the bracelet, and downstream for when the data or alerts are received into the app. When the device is activated, the location is stored by the app and transferred into a heat map. This map uses the trigger locations of all users and gives all users access to this map to help them avoid potentially dangerous situations.
There are 3 main competitors to the POM bracelet: Revelar, Tiker Personal Alarm, and Invisiware Smart Jewelry. What sets us apart from these products is, first, we are using location data to create a heat map of where these incidents occur. This data is encrypted and used to help colleges or users to understand what areas on campuses are problematic. Secondly, with our focus on everyday use, the watch capabilities allow for uses throughout the day besides the alarm. Finally, we know that not all situations are the same, and they call for different reactions. That's why Palm offers two different types of alarms. The first, for when things are getting uncomfortable, and you just need a friend to help you get out of the situation. And the second, for when the situation has gone too far, and you need to alert authorities or people nearby. Join the Palm family and help bring peace of mind to students all across America.
Judges, please turn on your microphones and your cameras. Do we have questions for Annabelle? And please, the audience as well, send in questions. John Carpenter, please go ahead.
Yeah, Annabelle, have you looked at having internet or cellular capability for the Palm in case the phone is off or is it out of range?
Well, we have in the app, you're going to make a like almost like a contact list with like five friends, I believe. And so when you add them, say you're going out one night and you know these are your five people you're going out with, it will send it to all of those. So in case one person's phone is dead or one person's connection is unstable, it will go to the other ones too. And also if you hold it and if you're in a really tough situation, you need help with by authorities, it will go to the nearest police station and help you.
Okay, and I was more asking about the individual's phone, if it ran out of battery or if it was out of range of the bracelet, if it would still be able to get out a signal.
I do have to look more into that, but I believe that even if it is out of battery, it will go just through the app and through, but that's a great question. I'll look more into that for sure.
Other questions from the judges? David Deal, please go ahead.
Is the user or the bracelet wearer in total control of who has access to location information?
Yes. So all data is actually encrypted. So you only will have your location shared once your fingerprint is activating the bracelet. So a lot of people were like nervous about hearing this because they thought it was another like Follow Me 360 app where parents can get your location, but you only can have your location accessed if you purposely put your fingerprint to it and hold it down to activate it. And yes, you will have a contact list of who you will reach out to for your location.
Great. We have a question from the audience, an anonymous attendee. How does this product set you apart from the rings and necklaces that serve as panic buttons that are currently available?
So what sets us apart is there is not only just a panic button, but it's a location and there's two different alarms. So before I went to college, my grandmother actually gave me my own personal safety alarm and it was supposed to be put on backpacks or keychains and there was only one signal and it ran, I think it went to 600 feet. But I'm realizing if you don't have a backpack, if you don't have your keychains on you, or even your phone now at times, if you give it to your friend while you're going to the bathroom, or if you don't have a pocket and you give it and you don't have the device on you, you'll be in trouble. But with this one, it not only will alarm if it needs to be, but it will also activate for if you're in an uncomfortable situation where you don't necessarily need to set off an alarm, but you'd like your friends to know where you are or if you're a little bit uncomfortable walking alone.
Thank you. Any other questions from our judges? Stephen Haig, please go ahead.
Thank you, Joshua. Annabelle, did you, as your team started to think about, ways to accessorize this, I noticed the description was stainless steel, on a rubber band type like thing, but have you thought about leather? Have you thought about, you know, gold? Have you thought about just the whole host of different varieties of things that could actually be put together, kind of mix and match according to the outfit you happen to be wearing that evening, something like that?
Yes, we did. At first, we really wanted just to have a simple bracelet that was versatile and that would go with everything that everybody could wear, not just girls who want to go out or got everybody can wear it, but we think that once we get the support, we will offer different colors, different sizes, and accessorize it for people.
Thank you.
Well, Annabelle, Dana, we have one more, our final question. Go ahead, Dana.
Annabelle, if I can just very quickly ask, again, my mind tends to go to broader markets. Have you considered potentially partnerships with public school systems or school systems in general? I mean, as a parent, this would be very, very interesting to have this kind of availability and this accessibility to small children. I think that it would be very interesting to talk to, again, parent groups as well as broader education entities.
Yeah, that's a great question. So as of now, because obviously marketing this is going to be hard with everybody in quarantine and we can't really reach as many people in person, we've been using online platform, but we hope that after this, we'll be able to go to schools such as like freshman orientations, because our target market is actually currently freshman women ages 17 to 19. So we hope that if we were marketing our product at the freshman orientation, we were able to actually really speak to the people that we're targeting. And then hopefully if we do it every year, by 4 years, the entire campus will be wearing these. And we want to really expand it to younger kids too. But right now we just wanted to have a clear, narrow target market so we can get started with it.
Wonderful. Annabelle, thank you very much. Judges, please score Palm. Okay. So judges, once you have scored Palm, please turn off your mics and cameras and then go to the Zoom room with Patrick or for the judging. Audience, it's time for the Audience Choice Award for the best pitch video. Audience, we appreciate your participation tonight. I apologize, I haven't been able to get to all the questions. Please select the team you believe had the best and most effective pitch video. Trevor, will you please post the poll? Audience, the poll on your screen will be up for the next 60 seconds. Please make your selection. As we move to the second part of the night, it's with great pleasure that I get to introduce our two guest speakers tonight. Bill Powell is a partner and managing director at Stadia Ventures, an early stage venture capital fund and accelerator, investing in sports tech, human performance, and esports and gaming. Bill is currently an angel in residence at the University of Denver, where he enjoys advising students on startup live pitches and capital formation. And of course, he loves being part of the Madden Challenge. He's a proud alum of Daniels, where he earned his MS in finance and international MBA degrees in the mid-2000s. Bill will introduce our speaker, Meredith Nix, the founder and CEO of Nix. Bill, I'll stop sharing my screen and please take it from here.
Great, thanks so much, Josh. Thanks for your kind words. Let me just pull up my, I just lost part of my page here. There we go. Thanks for your kind words. It's, you know, it's really great to be able to spend this evening with all the students, professors, judges, and guests of the entrepreneurship program at DU by being part of something like the Madden Challenge. I'd like to commend all the teams on putting together such awesome pitches. It's just great teamwork, which is what Startup Life is all about. At Stadia, we've hosted over 10 cohorts over the last 5 years with founders and teams from all over the US and around the world, making some 50 investments along the way. And we're fortunate enough to count our guest speaker tonight as an alum of Stadia Ventures since fall 2016. Meredith Cass is the founder and CEO of Nix Biosensors, a consumer health data startup spun out of Harvard University. Nix's initial product is a sweat sensor that informs athletes, soldiers, and laborers of their hydration status, sweat rate, electrolyte loss, and core body temperature in real time. She's a serial company starter, an entrepreneur who's worked closely with several Boston and New York venture capital firms while creating seven life science and consumer startups prior to Nix. Additionally, she sits on the board of several companies and nonprofits, including Girls on the Run of Greater Boston, the Consumer Technology Association's Health and Fitness Technology Division, and the Cambridge School Friends School, of which she is an alumna. She received her undergrad from Bryn Mawr College, where she was the recipient of the Annapel Wheeler Prize for Mathematics, and received her MBA from HBS, Harvard Business School. She's a Kauffman Fellow and a Harvard Business School Blavatnik Fellow. And if all of that's not enough, Meredith was even a college basketball player turned marathoner who's now completed 9 marathons in the past 6 years, including all the world major marathons. Wow. With no further ado, it's my distinct pleasure to hand it off to tonight's guest speaker, Meredith Cass.
Thanks, Bill. And thanks so much for having me. It's such a treat to be able to see you guys' pitches. I can't fathom what that's been like trying to do that while you're all collaborating remotely. It's hard enough in our company. We're trying to get our company to, you know, our small team to work collaboratively while we're all working from home. So I commend you guys, and of course, super biased, but love seeing all the biosensors and IoT and connected devices. That's where Nick's plays specifically. So I'll get to Nick's in a second, but you know, I was kindly invited by Bill and Josh, and thank you both again for having me to just tell a little bit of my founder story. And I didn't technically start Nick's until I was in my mid-30s, but had a lot of experience in the startup and venture capital world before that. And I think, you know, throughout my career, as I've been meeting entrepreneurs and venture capitalists and angel investors, you know, it's really easy to look at some of those folks and think, you know, that someone's career path just made perfect sense and it was perfectly fluid and every step they took really, you know, flowed from one position to the next and kind of set them up to be entrepreneurs. And you know, the reality is that's not really how a job sort of path or a career path evolves. In fact, it really only makes sense in hindsight, you know, in retrospect. And, you know, there aren't sort of prescribed steps to, you know, what you major in or what you do after school to become an entrepreneur or anything like that. So, you know, it's something that probably sounds really simple, but I don't think I fully appreciated that for quite some time after I graduated, of thinking, you know, if I want to be in venture capital or if I want to be a startup founder, I've got to take these sort of specific prescribed steps. And that's just really not how it works. So I say all that going into my founder story and my career path, because I think it's a really important realization for anyone who may be tempted to think like, oh, well, I don't have that background, or I didn't, you know, I wasn't a consultant, or I didn't go into investment banking after college. You know, I couldn't possibly go down this path. You know, I think for me, a friend recently defined entrepreneurship as, you know, an entrepreneur's job is just every day you're solving problems and finding answers to questions that you're not expected to know, but you are expected to go and find the answers. And I think really the best, most effective way to do that is leveraging true, genuine, authentic relationships with people that you've built along the way. It starts with your classmates and your professors, onto your colleagues and people that you meet along the way. And, you know, people that you're kind and helpful to that want to be kind and helpful back. And so that candidly is kind of how I've gotten through my career, you know, step by step. And anyway, with no further ado. So my background has mostly been in healthcare. As Bill mentioned, it's really been at this intersection between venture capital and venture creation for the most part. And when I say venture creation, I mean startups. So there are quite a few funds, at least in the Boston area. This is a pretty popular model for really early stage venture capital in healthcare, is that they will take a venture creation model to their portfolio development, where a traditional model would be, you know, investing in, you know, very promising companies that they come across. A venture creation model would mean collaborating with oftentimes academic stage inventors and researchers and helping them commercialize their own technologies and innovations. So I was very fortunate to be able to start companies from that perspective, about 6 or 7 companies before Nick's, and did have the benefit of sort of seeing how the sausage gets made, for lack of a better phrase. So I did that with a few firms, again, here in Boston, one in New York, and then I actually went over to Children's Hospital here in Boston and kind of did the same thing within the hospital. So Children's Hospital here is linked to Harvard Medical School. It's the pediatric hospital in that system, And so all of the researchers at Children's Hospital have a dual appointment at Harvard Medical School. And I had the incredible opportunity to work with some of the most renowned researchers, inventing all sorts of things and discovering all sorts of things that are not just pediatric innovations, from, you know, drug development, medical device, diagnostic, healthcare IT. So I ran that fund at Children's for a couple of years, helping them spin companies out of the research side of the hospital. And then I actually went back to Harvard Business School. This was many years after I had graduated, where they had a new program that they were rolling out. This was the Blavatnik Fellowship that Bill mentioned, where I had this unbelievable opportunity that no entrepreneur ever really has, which is 12 months of salary support, health insurance, office space on campus, a small startup budget, and some other perks and benefits that come with being staff at Harvard Business School. And that sort of 12-month runway to identify, very much as you guys have done, culminating in this project here, identifying a space that I felt was ripe with opportunity, coming up with a business strategy around that, and hopefully finding some traction to raise some funding based on that concept at the end of it. And it was sort of fortuitous that I met Stadia Ventures pretty much as that concept had started to come together, and that fellowship year, that 12 months, kind of came to a close. So very, very fortunate that, first of all, that I had the opportunity to work 100% of my time, instead of trying to cram this into nights and weekends like a lot of entrepreneurs have to do, to come up with this concept and start to build traction toward it. So where that concept came from for me actually touches a lot of the areas that your companies have touched on. And it really came from the healthcare side first, being that was my background. So this concept of, realizing that, and I think it was Biotech Forever Evolving really flirted with this line here of, the patient and the consumer. And if you think about it, every single one of us is a patient at some point during the day or the week or the month, when we do go to the doctor or the hospital, but we're a consumer every other point in time. And there are all sorts of products and services and things like that are really blurring this line. And it does come in some cases from platforms like the Apple Watch, which is decidedly a consumer electronics product, but is obviously being used in all sorts of clinical health studies and things like that. So that trend in particular really intrigued me. The second one was an ever sort of growing pressure to reduce healthcare costs in this country. And a big part of that has really shifted us in recent years to moving away from this sort of, episodic sick care, which is kind of how our healthcare system is set up, that somebody only gets medical attention when they are sick and formally engages with a setting of care like the doctor's office or the hospital. And that has really shifted for years, but really, especially in the last 5 to 10 years, where there's a much stronger emphasis now on preventive health and wellness that really happens on a day-to-day basis, not just when you're in a formal setting of care. So looking at these trends, my thought was there is no more powerful tool in pushing some of these major healthcare trends forward than the category of products that we call biosensors, which I sort of think of as any kind of connected device that is gathering biometric data of any kind on topics of health and wellness on a day-to-day basis that can be culminated in a way that really supports intervention or insight that wasn't there previously. And I love what wearables have attempted to do by using, simple off-the-shelf technologies like accelerometry and heart rate and GPS and things like that to try to, gain insights from that data about health and wellness. And sports is often sort of the, early kind of adoption segment that people think about in that vein. But what I really felt was missing was instead of using those sorts of technologies really leaping over into leveraging a lot of the technology that the healthcare industry already has. And that is a wealth of well-understood and identified biomarkers that can be available completely non-invasively through samples like sweat and tears, saliva, breast milk, exhaled breath, and packaging that in a way that can go back to the consumer. And so for me, this concept came to, you know, moving away from these sort of non-specific markers like GPS and accelerometry and moving toward more specific electrochemical markers that are available in these fluid sources, but doing it on topics that consumers care about, what I really didn't want to do at that point in my career, and just sort of seeing how the world was evolving. And candidly, having spent time in venture capital and healthcare, what I didn't want to do was start a true biotech company. I think I just sort of had some PTSD from the companies I'd helped develop in the past around the just myriad risks that surround traditional biotech or med device or diagnostic companies, including regulatory risk by the FDA, technical and clinical risk in the first place. Is it going to work? Is it not? Can you validate it? Reimbursement risk, who's going to pay for it? Typically, out-of-pocket payment can be prohibitively expensive for consumers. So you've got to get someone to pay for it, usually an insurer, a health insurance company. All of these sorts of risks, capital intensity, because you are doing clinical studies. So for me, it was about starting with a consumer segment and starting with a metric that people genuinely cared about from the consumer side. And so hydration really kind of came to the top of that application list for us, in large part because the potential scale when we think about hydration management is massive. I mean, it's as fundamental as humankind, and yet it really kind of carves out for us several segments that struggle with hydration even more significantly, either because the risk or the frequency of dehydration is higher, or because the consequences of it are higher. And so what that looks like for us is athletes, both endurance athletes, running, cycling, triathlon, but also team sports, football, soccer, tennis, and so on. But these are hockey. Some of these are the greatest need cases. But military, it's a huge problem in the military, where most basic training facilities are in the southern states where it's hot and humid. And a segment that has surprised us a little bit, but we've been getting quite a few inbound inquiries over the last year, is the occupational health setting. So firefighting, construction working, agricultural workers, manufacturing or factory workers where the conditions are particularly hot. And so we built a really sort of ugly sensor at first, if I'm honest, just to prove out the concept. We recently downsized it. I always like showing this off, even though it's not a commercial ready prototype. We have a disposable component, which gets a 90% product margin, which we're really excited about, and a durable component, which is still bigger than it will be when we go to market, but we're pretty proud of the progress that we've made there. And of course, that piece is Bluetooth connected to your phone or other existing hardware devices. So we are rolling out pilots now. We're really excited to be working with elite athletes. We've got a whole pipeline of pilots that we're doing with people like the Texas Rangers, the Miami Heat, Lance Armstrong, although he's a bit of a controversial figure. I'm talking to Maria Sharapova tomorrow. So we've been really lucky about our access across this whole range for us, again, of athletes, military, and laborers, and are excited to push forward. And we've been really grateful for the support of people like Stadia Ventures and Bill Powell for all of the financial support, but more importantly, you know, the genuine relationships that we've built within our advisory community, our investor community, to push forward and meet partners and, you know, achieve validation and hopefully launch our product in December of this year. So that's my story. I'm gonna stop there and see if there are questions. Thanks again for having me.
Meredith, thanks so much for taking time to share your story, your journey. It is quite a journey. And I think that's really the word, right? I mean, for most entrepreneurs,
absolutely,
It's all about the journey. So I just kind of wanted to let the audience know they should go ahead and submit some more questions if they can. We do have one teed up here, and we've got a host of others as well. So I guess I'll kind of jump in. Meredith, you didn't really mention this during your talk, which I can appreciate, but you and I are both people. So I'm going to hit you with with one. I've known you some time. I'm really saying, so, you know, your talks and pitches, they always kind of leave me a little thirsty at the end. I feel a little dehydrated, but they're very popular, right? And you've I don't know how many pitch competitions you've been in, let alone one. I know you took home South by Southwest for your category a couple years ago, a year ago or so. ASICS, Reebok, Harvard, I don't know, Stadia, Sports and Fitness Industry Association here in Denver even. So what are some of your tips and tricks? You know, we saw a lot of great presentations from students, a lot of hard work, a tough time to do this in this virtual world. You're used to being on one stage, this is very large, and now you're here in Zoom. What are some of the tips and tricks you've learned along the way?
Yeah, and I have to commend everybody who presented tonight. This is a forum that it can be really hard, especially when you're not able to make a sort of a personal one-on-one connection with somebody when you're pitching. I mean, for me, honestly, the key has been keep it conversational. So if you're having a direct kind of conversation with somebody or an entire group, you know, not memorizing what you're trying to say, not scripting it, you know, if you know what you're talking about, it doesn't have to be, you know, sort of memorized or scripted. It's, you know, somebody will ask you a question, you know the answer, you can just do that sort of in conversation. And I think that really brings out, you know, an excitement or a passion in the team and the founder, in a way that, you know, when something's scripted, it can be much, much harder to do. And I think it's, you know, it's always important to be able to sort of cite the traction. Everybody's always talking about elevator pitch. And it's really hard when you've got something that's timed, but there are always little tricks that you can do depending on, you know, how the sort of pitch is set up. And one of my tricks that I was talking about recently is when you finish your pitch, I don't know why I love this one so much. You finish your pitch, you get to sort of your thank you slide and it says Q&A. And I always like underneath to say, ask me about, and then I have a couple bullets of topics that I wasn't able to get to. With some
backslides
and appendix
slides,
and that one's kind of fun.
I've seen you do that, and I think it's pretty great. I like another one I've seen you do. You kind of click through. Oh, whoops! Like you into some appendices, which elicit questions from the audience. It never hurts to give people a little fodder to lead them down the critical path of questioning. So one of the questions. We have here is from Colleen. She says she loves what you're doing and she's working on virtual worlds and behavior modification. And is curious if you have an opinion on that.
Yeah, I mean, behavior modification comes in a lot of flavors. My sort of strongest familiarity with that is more on the medical side. So when you're talking about chronic diseases in particular, you know, this is huge when you're talking about diabetes and heart disease and diseases where, forgive me for sort of thinking of it this way, where it sometimes often has that sort of lifestyle component to it, where behavior modification or behavior change is absolutely the key to, you know, stopping disease progression or even thinking about disease reversal. And it's hard. I mean, this was something that became really popular probably in like the early 2000s when it was, you know, becoming much more obvious that there were sort of these four or five core chronic disease areas that were causing, you know, the lion's share of the expense in the healthcare industry. And behavior modification or behavior change was thought for a long time to be the key to you know, reducing a lot of these healthcare costs. So my sentiment around that is that it can be really powerful. But man, is it an uphill battle to try to get someone to change the behavior that feels comfortable and natural to them.
Thanks for sharing that. I'm going to jump back into something perhaps a little more closer to home. And it's really regarding how you made your transition. You know, I always find it, you know, being an undergrad, you think about that first job really matters. what you do. It sets a course. It's an icon. You were talking about pitching before. I think about branding. I think about personal brand and what it means, how you grew into that role of becoming an entrepreneur. What are some, you know, how important was that, those first steps in terms of formation to where you are now?
Yeah, I mean, it's especially when you think about sort of, I mean, I'm at a stage now where I think I'll probably be an entrepreneur for life, and hopefully Knicks will be wildly successful, you know, whether it gets acquired and, you know, whether I stay on or not. I do see myself as a serial entrepreneur. I've always got ideas sort of percolating in the back of my head. You know, it's easy to think, you know, especially when I was, earlier in my career coming out of school, it's easy to think like, oh, I don't know that yet. I don't know how to get to be an entrepreneur. No one's going to take me seriously. Is that the other thing? And I really think, you know, the key to building momentum and building traction, which by the way is the primary thing that's going to get you to that next sort of milestone and that next bit of traction, is just about very clearly showing that you know your stuff and you've done your homework, and telling a story. And I don't mean that in a facetious way. I mean, actually weaving a story that people can get behind and say, man, Meredith knows her stuff. I'm gonna go along for the ride. And doing that in a genuine, authentic way. And unfortunately, that means sometimes having to admit when I make a misstep or I've missed something or I don't know the answer to a question. But all of that in my mind just breeds further authenticity and trust with investors, with partners. You know, if they can say, you know, Meredith seems like a really down-to-earth person, not only does she know her stuff, but I can trust her. You know, I don't think there's necessarily a prescribed path. I think it's more about the relationships that you build and the credibility you can build along the way.
Yeah. Which leads you down that pathway of connection into commercial opportunities, investors, all kinds of people. I see that the judges are just about done here. So we've got some more questions, but I'm going to just round out with one last one here. I think it's, you hit on some of the things I really like: genuine, authentic. It's what we look for in entrepreneurs. One of the things that we've heard a lot more recently here during COVID is the return of this phrase, entrepreneurship is a team sport. So collaboration, which even feels more disrupted, just the notion of collaboration being disrupted during COVID. I mean, there's this resurgence of, doubt, barriers going down. How important are the qualities and characteristics that you already mentioned when you're building out a company and a team in this type of environment?
Oh, completely essential, completely essential. And I mean, I think the world is still navigating what this looks like. I'm sure all the teams here tonight, you know, trying to figure out how do we work together and put together a pitch while we're all doing it from, you know, three or four different cities. I mean, it's a challenge. And you know, people have always worked from home in certain capacities, but not 100% of the time, you know, when their team's completely dispersed. So I think it's even more critical now than ever. And it's really hard to, you know, really make a sort of relationship type connection with somebody when you're doing it over Zoom. You know, thank God those technologies are there, because who knows where we would be if this was 15, 20 years ago. Yeah, I mean, the challenges are real. They're there for everyone, whether you're a student or a professor or an entrepreneur.
That's great. Well, thanks, Meredith. And I know that Josh, I think you're ready. I don't see you on there yet. There you are. Thanks so much for taking time, Meredith. And
I'm going to
there are some other questions still in the Q&A, and I'll send those on to you after this.
Great.
And Meredith, thank you so much for making time tonight. I know you're on the East Coast. It's a little bit later of a night, but it's so empowering to see someone that's had the success that you've had and to talk to these young entrepreneurs. So truly appreciate it. And Bill, as always, I appreciate all your help and all that you do for the Entrepreneur Program and the Business School. So thank you both.
Thanks, guys. Good luck to all the teams.
Good luck.
So the judges have come back. Judges, if you would do me a favor and go ahead and turn on your mics and turn on your video. And what I would like to do before we start is I would like to have you make a couple remarks, spend a few minutes We'd love to hear comments, feedback, and advice you have for the teams presenting tonight, and also all the teams and students in the audience, these budding entrepreneurs. So, David, would you like to start?
Sure. You know, one thing that I kept coming back to that I was impressed with was keeping in mind that you did all this remotely. And some of the teams in particular were clearly interactive with part of the presentation owned by all of them, and I thought that was really impressive. I also liked that you found a way to stay focused on a particular area and stayed with that, because each of the products I think had a natural ability to start imagining what else they might apply to and other revenue streams you might pull in from. So I was impressed with the discipline to stay focused.
Absolutely, thank you. Any other judges, comments, feedback?
I'll just comment, Josh, and just say I thought the teams did a wonderful job, and it's always challenging to deal with everything remotely. And I know that trying to manage a team and do remote development. And I really think that each one of the teams had different skill sets that they brought to bear. And really, each team member brought something unique to making the team a success. And I thought they all did a great job and really assembled some nice quality YouTube videos, given, you know, a short time constraint of working on this during a quarter.
Thank you, John. Clark, I believe you had your hand up.
Yeah, so thank you to all the teams for presenting. You all did a wonderful job. I think I'm going to have to come back and speak at Joshua's class next year again, because we got to get some cryptocurrency participants in here next time.
I'll second that one.
Yeah, but great job. You know, one thing that we think about at a venture-backed startup at ShapeShift, where I work, is scalability. It's one of the things that drives a lot of the decisions that we make. And so naturally, as undergrads, I imagine, as I was, you're focused on like an end-user retail experience. We actually do focus on a lot of that at ShapeShift, but I'd encourage all of you to continue to think about potential enterprise solutions as well, and business to business products and deliveries and presentations like that. You know, two in particular really stood out to me, the plant parents as well as the planners. You know, I was thinking about our office space in Denver, and there's got to be 1,000 plants at least in our building, right? So if you think about selling that to our building owners or something like that, as well as, you know, I couldn't, you know, can't even count the number of different calendar apps that we've got to try and make our workflows more efficient. So if you could theoretically sell that into companies at an enterprise level, it's just that much more scalable.
Well said.
Great job, everybody.
Well said. Stephen, go ahead. I saw your hand pop up.
Thank you, Joshua. Well, to all the teams, fantastic. And hey, Joshua, to you and your team, what a wonderful event. And this has just gone so smoothly. And so it's really been nice. Congratulations, Joshua, on job well done. But to the teams, job really well done. And, you know, my word for all of you is a pretty simple word, and it's called passion. And I'm guessing that in the Elements team, there's somebody who owns a pretty nice guitar or, whatever it happens to be. And in the planners, they've tried to deal with busy life schedules. And plant parents, it was obvious they were killing plants. Not that, you know, they didn't want to, but it was happening. You know, Canopy, probably somebody has a, there's a team member who has a story in the background about skin cancer or melanoma or something like that. And I'll tell each and every one of you teams that if you chase your passion, okay, and you hold true to your beliefs and everything that's sacred to you, you will be successful. And all the money in the world that you need will follow. And so I was really, really pleased to see the big, huge variety that it was really obvious that these were passionate ideas to the teams, or at least to some of the individuals on the teams, because passion carries you through the times as an entrepreneur when things are going downhill, when things are tough, when things are at a standstill, when things are at a stalemate. Your passion will take you to the next level and to the next step. So congratulations to all the teams.
Well said. Kanitha, go ahead, please.
Asha, thanks so much for inviting me to join in on this. The students did such an incredible job. Like Stephen said, the passion, it completely just is so incredible to witness these amazing ideas coming out of this very weird time. And innovation is alive and well during this pandemic, and the students are perfect proof of that. And these ideas are a great proof of that. I would love to talk about Project Excite for a second and let the students know that if any of you are interested in continuing to work on your ideas in your companies, we're here on campus to support you, and we'd love to continue to do that through our incubator or accelerator grants or mentor network. Amazing job. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Kenneth, and I'd be happy to make the introduction for all teams, not only teams that are in the Madden Challenge, but other teams that have ideas that Project Excite can help you grow those ideas. Awesome organization on campus. Andrew, I saw your hand up. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to kind of ditto on what a lot of others said. You know, great. It was really fun. Also, as I was starting to write questions down at times, then you answered them. Things on, you know, data privacy, security, you know, issues like that. I thought that was, you know, really well done, and you took it into a whole nother level. And it's also harder to be a judge on this side of the camera versus being there in person, you know, trying to, you know, get a read on what's happening and how are things going. So job well done. And, you know, Joshua, thanks for the invite.
Of course, you're welcome. Dana, please go ahead.
I guess I'm last. First of all, Joshua, thank you for the invitation. It's really an honor to get a chance to see some of these really exciting projects. And I guess the one thing, I feel like Meredith stole my speech, that once you become an entrepreneur, all you see are gaps. And it's not that there are not places in offices for all of us, but you know, it's kind of a be careful what you wish for, because all you ever see now are the gaps. And I would encourage all of the project teams, you're all amazing. And yes, keep your passion and learn how to tell a story. That passion, it starts from somewhere, and use your data to tell the story of why this matters and why this is important and why it's so it's such a big project for you. That is incredibly powerful. And the last thing I guess I would say, I was talking to colleagues at a dinner in September, and they were all debating on whether it was the right time to start this company that they wanted. And I would just say, there's really not a great time. There's not a perfect time. There's not a bad time. Take your ideas and run, because if you wait for the perfect moment, you might never jump.
Dana, that's great advice. Telling a story is very hard to do. Practice, 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 because it can be so effective. It goes a long way. Judges, great, great advice. Truly, truly appreciate it. So let me share my screen again. And so before we start with the awards, I'd like to thank all the professors that teach the Fourth Industrial Revolution course. It takes a team and a lot of teamwork. It's a pleasure to work with all of these individuals. And a special shout out this quarter to Professor Riley and Dr. Hanaway, my two teaching partners this spring quarter. We had to pivot, we had to make changes, we had to move fast, but it was a blast. Thanks for making it so much fun. And to the rest of you, I look forward to teaching with you again in the fall quarter. Okay, let's move. Time to get to the awards. The first is the Audience Choice Award for Best Pitch. Each team member on the winning team will receive $100 gift certificate to spend at the DU bookstore. The winner of the Spring 2020 Madden Challenge Audience Choice Award for the best pitch is Plant Parent. Congratulations, Plant Parent. We don't have time to walk through, and I talked to every team member again, but well done. Congratulations for winning the Audience Pitch Award.
Thank you guys so much. Sorry, I know I shouldn't say anything.
But no, that's cool. I love it. Okay, before we move on to the judges' choice, I want to spend a minute. Before we announce the winner of the Madden Challenge, I want to acknowledge a very special person, a friend and a mentor, Dr. Stephen Haig. And you may notice him as one of the judges. This was the first time he's ever been able to be a judge, because up until this quarter, he ran the Madden Challenge. It was his idea. Stephen's vision has helped to foster and grow entrepreneurism at the University of Denver. Stephen had this vision in 2011 for the Gateway to Business course, which eventually became what is now known as the Fourth Industrial Revolution course, a course taken by over 700 students each year. Stephen started the entrepreneurship minor in the Madden Challenge. It was his vision, it was his baby. I know that I speak for everyone at the university. We are very grateful for all that Stephen does, and I personally look forward to working with Stephen in the future as we start to execute on all your new ideas. And I know a few of them, and I know others are percolating. So I felt it was very important to acknowledge Stephen tonight.
Thank you, Joshua. Thank you very much.
Well honored and deserved. Okay, let's announce the first, second, and third place winners for the Spring 2020 Madden Challenge. The team receiving the third place in the Spring 2020 Madden Challenge, and I made a change. Second and third place, we're not going to receive prize money. But I felt these teams worked so hard on phase one, on phase two, and then prepping for the Madden Challenge, that it was only right to offer prize money for the first place, second place, and third place. Second and third place, we'll announce you. We won't have, you can give a quick shout out, but the only time a group will have time to listen to is the team that wins. But nonetheless, third place in the Spring 2020 Madden Challenge is the Elements. Well done, the Elements. Fantastic job, Sophie, Murphy, Jackson, and James. Second place for Spring 2020 Madden Challenge. Each team member will win $200. Second place, and also the team that won the audience award, is Plant Parent. Congratulations to the team at Plant Parent. Tony, Liv, Michael, Samantha, and Joshua. Excellent job. Well done. And what we've all been waiting for, all the hard work, the winning pitch video for the Spring 2020 Madden Challenge. The winning team, each team member wins $500. Not a bad way to start your summer. Very proud of all seven teams. You represented the university, the Daniels College of Business, plus, to use a baseball metaphor, you hit it out of the park tonight. You should all be proud. I'm very impressed with what you did tonight. The winning team is Palm. Congratulations, Palm. And Annabelle, if you want to say a couple words, please.
Thank you so much.
Do you any stories, anything that you want to convey about struggles, late nights, trying to coordinate?
Time change was a little bit hard. Just figuring out any time to like meet, that was really difficult. But I mean, we were very communicative and we're always texting and figuring out times that worked with each other. So, and everybody was really cooperative. So it really worked out well.
Awesome. Well, hey, congratulations. Thanks. You guys deserve it. Congratulations, Palm. So in closing, I'd like to thank everyone that made tonight possible. There were a number of people that were integral to the success of the Madden Challenge event. A huge shout out to my friend Patrick Orr for handling the judging. This was no small task and your help is truly appreciated. Oh. I would also like to thank Trevor Haig and Tremaine Fisher for all the work behind the scenes. Truly appreciated. And judges, thank you for your time tonight. In closing, students, this is the first step in your entrepreneurship journey. Celebrate the victories, analyze the mistakes, and continue to move forward. Take what the judges told you tonight, their advice, the passion, the stories, looking at the big picture. Use that to move forward. I am very lucky. I have the opportunity to work with young adults every day, and I admire their passion, the commitment, their curiosity. I'm very excited for this generation. Anything is possible, regardless of the current social, political, and economic situation. There is always opportunity. There is always opportunity. So students, you need to believe in your ideas and dreams. Anything is possible. Continue to innovate and always look to the future. Take your ideas, talk to the Office of Entrepreneurship, talk to Project Excite. We're here to help you build these ideas into reality. Thank you, everyone, and good night.